I bought this PSP on eBay for about $29 US, and it has this big crack in the front, and I hope the LCD itself is okay. A new case should help. The box says not for sale, so I hope it's an original spare part. Also, it won't turn on, looks like the battery is dead as well and needs to be replaced. Let's fix that, shall we? First, let's see if the PSP will turn on with the power adapter itself. Okay, that seems to work. Houston, we have a picture with sound. Perfect. Buttons works as well. Nice. Let me start a timer to better understand how long this process will take. By the way, this game was included, but it is damaged as well. We will check it out later in the process. I bought a replacement battery. Let's see if it works with the new battery. By the way, I put some product links in the description for reference. At least we are seeing some voltage here, that's a good sign. Here's the proof, a new battery solves our power problem. Nice. Let's start with the disassembly. We need to remove the screws inside the battery compartment. There are also some screws hidden under the warranty sticker. Those sneaky guys. You can't miss the other screws, the two screws on the right and the middle one from the front. Here we go. Ouch, that doesn't look good. Let's try to clean it up with 99% IPA, aka isopropyl alcohol, and a cotton swab. This looks much better now. I think the LCD is fine. This is brilliant. Time to check out the shell in the promising box. So far so good. We need to find a way to remove the screen. The button bar below the screen must be disconnected and removed by prying off both edges. Now we do the same thing with the screen itself. We need to be careful when we take off the screen. The trick is to tilt it from the top down. Next we unhook the ribbon cables and take the screen off. After the screen is no longer in the way, we can remove its mount as well. Now let's remove the right side PCB, including the ribbon cable with the right shoulder button. The D-pad and the left shoulder button are the next ones. The speaker connectors are very fragile. I use a wide tweezer with some profile for better grip. The speaker itself is hard to get out. Move it up slowly. We will repeat the same process for the opposite side. Let's dig deeper and remove the visible cables, including the DC jack. The orange foil with the attached cable is the Wi-Fi antenna. We will remove this as well. Finally, we can remove the motherboard of our PSP. What a beauty! Next is the metal shield and the left daughterboard with the memory stick reader. To remove the backplate, it is necessary to pry it from both sides. The prying isn't over yet. The metal part of the disk drive needs to be removed in the same way. We can now see the inner workings of the UMD drive. To completely free the drive, we need to remove four screws and lift it out of the case. There are some rubber damper rings that we don't want to lose. Here you can see the spring of the drive. For easier removal, I cut some of the plastic with a side cutter. The disassembly process is complete. Here you can see the new button part of the case. Before reassembling our unit, we need to remove some covers and the back panel. The UMD drive needs some cleaning. Let us clean it carefully with some IPA, including the laser. I transferred the label from the original case to the new one. We can now screw the UMD drive back in. Putting the metal mechanism with the spring back in is a bit tricky. Let's take it easy and not rush. The back panel is easier to reassemble, just snap it from edge to edge. time to reassemble the memory stick reader. Couldn't hurt to give it a little cleaning. Reattaching the Wi-Fi antenna. Screw everything back in place, including the metal shielding. The motherboard would be next, but first we need to transfer the old IR cover from the old case to the new one. It's pretty stuck, let's just cut it free with a side cutter. And here it is. Let's put it in our new case. Perfect. Now to the mentioned motherboard. A little cleaning, as always. Remounting the Wi-Fi antenna. Grab the DC power jack and make sure it is clean for a good connection. Insert cable and screw it back into place. Reinstall the remaining ribbon cables. The speakers are our next stop. Give them a quick clean, put them back in and reattach the cables. And the second speaker. We also clean the D-pad and reassemble it, including the left shoulder button. Screw back the LCD mounting plate. The UMD opening mechanism seems to work fine. Nice. The analog stick must be removed from the old case. The usual cleaning procedure. And it is time to remove the foil from our new faceplate. That's kinda weird. There's some residue left after you peel off the foil. Is it because it has been several years since anyone removed the foil? Strange. Anyway, let us install the analog stick into the new case. I just realized that I forgot to put the plate in the first place. Place the plate first and screw it in place. Reinstall the screen and the ribbon cables. Then we reinstall the button bar and the right board. At this point, I am unable to turn on the PSP. Do you think you could spot why it's not working out? Yep, I forgot the right shoulder button. It's also responsible for connecting the right board, including the power button, to the motherboard. To fix this, we need to go back a few steps in the process. Here we go, this is the mentioned ribbon cable. Reconnect it to the main board and we should be good to go. Nice. Let's do a quick test to see if we see some light. A green light, perfect. Let's quickly redo the steps where we were before. But do we also get an image with the attached screen? Time to find out! Oh yeah! The new front case is missing some components, the transparent pieces that help distribute the LED lights evenly. One side is finished, now the other. Both in place. the D-pad membrane we need from the old case. Give it a good clean. Instead of a cotton swab and IPA, we could also use a wet wipe. Now we reinsert the D-pad itself. The four buttons for the right side require some puzzling. To mount the long plastic button bar, I cut off a small strip of double-sided tape. Not sure if gluing is really necessary, but we will find out, I guess. We are very close to the point where we can merge the case's bottom and front plate. But before doing that, we need to be sure that no dust or fingerprints are left on the screen. As a start, I'm using some dust removal stickers I had lying around from my last video where I fixed a broken Apple Watch glass for only 20 bucks. The second stage is to clean it with a screen cleaner. I take my time for this step. Unfortunately, we have some glue around the screen, making it hard to clean the edges. A dust blower may help remove some loose dust. Let's insert the right shoulder button. Taking the new shiny L&R buttons out of the back. With my head in the way, some more cleaning. The moment of truth. Let's try to merge both halves. So far it fits, and the buttons are working fine, except for the button bar below the screen. The tactile feedback doesn't feel right. Let's remove the double-sided tape from the button bar. The plastic parts keep falling off the case. That's driving me nuts. The second attempt is incoming. It feels still too mushy in my opinion. I'm afraid it's not an original spare part. Let's try removing the button bar from the initial case. I'm such an idiot. I ripped it.
You are such an idiot.
Unfortunately, my camera stopped recording at that point and I lost about 45 minutes of footage. Let's quickly go through what I did during this time. I removed the left residue with the help of a screen cleaner. You might remember it looks something like this. Afterward, I discovered a strange behavior with the UMD eject mechanism. After merging the bottom and the front part of the case, the UMD drive won't correctly close any longer. It snaps back to the open position. The only way to lock it in place is to close it with a button, preventing it from snapping back. This problem took me a lot of time, and I couldn't fix it. The front case seemed to be scrubbing against the mechanism, so I tried to use a rotary tool to grind it, but unfortunately that didn't help. Please let me know if someone knows what could be wrong. This reinforces my suspicion that it's not an original replacement case. What a bummer. The not for sale label was so promising. Even the font itself looks different from the original one. Let's insert the battery and see if it works. Green light. Image. And the iconic startup sound. It could be a lot worse. But will it work with the game in the UMD drive? Let's find out. As mentioned at the beginning of the video, the game shell is damaged. The only fix I can think of it is to use some scotch tape. The disc looks quite dirty. Let's try cleaning it with IPA and a sensor cleaning swab. Will it work? Let's insert the game and see what happens. I can hear the UMD drive reading the disk. It took a while. UMD? And we are listening to some beautiful Star Wars tunes. Nice. Another issue with the fake shell is that I can't see the right edge of the screen, which should not be visible. The game boots up fine. Let's see if the memory stick reader works. Insert the 1GB memory stick that came with the PSP. It works! The game continues. Let's fast forward to the point where we are in the game itself. And here we are in the cantina with its beautiful sound. All of the buttons work without any issues. Beside the eject mechanism issue, I'm very happy with the outcome. Should we mod the PSP in an upcoming episode? Let me know in the comments.